Hello. Welcome to my session. My name's Alan Birchall. This session is Windows 8 getting better with group policy and work folders. I work for Avanade Australia. If you might have told by the accent, I'm from Australia. I'm an IT consultant. My day job is pretty much an Active Directory administrator and a PKI administrator. My nighttime role is author-in-chief of the Group Policy Central website, www.grouppolicy.biz. If you're interested in anything group policy related, I highly recommend you go to my website and subscribe to it in whatever format you like to subscribe to it. I also have a Twitter account. If you like all things Microsoft and geeky and Twitter and you're one of those Twitter people, please follow me at Alan Birchall. In the Gold Coast, I asked people to follow me and I got 30 new followers. So I reckon New Zealand, you've got a challenge there. If I can get 30 new followers from Australia, let's see if we can get more from New Zealand. So, group policy and work folders. What are we going to talk about? Well, I'm going to talk about what's new in group policy, specifically what's new in group policy in Windows 8.1. All right. There's a couple of new improvements in Windows 8.1. It is a point release, so there are not major improvements with group policy, and I'm talking about the core group policy functionality. If I come out to here, I can look at the people at the front of the stage here, rather than behind the monitor. See? Good top marks, remember that. I'm also going to be talking about work folders. Now, on the surface, these two things seem to be very different technologies, and it's somewhat true, but different things can go well together really well. Like kiwi fruit and pavlova. All right? Kiwi fruit, I hope, comes from New Zealand. It's not one of those things like macadamia nuts in Australia where it doesn't actually come from Australia. And pavlova, well, there's some contention of where that came from. I think the umpire has called that once in New Zealand, so I'll give you that one. But it's like those two things together. They're great apart, but together they're form a really fantastic partnership. Okay. So first of all, I'm going to talk about group policy. But first, you might be saying, hang on, Windows 8 came out 12 months ago. What's new in group policy in Windows 8? Who was in my Windows 8 session last year about group policy? Couple of hands. All right. For those that you weren't in that session, I'm not going to go back and talk about Windows 8 group policy stuff. There's a lot of great resources, funnily enough, by me. One is a Channel 9 video, URL's there, so I highly recommend you download the entire slide deck after this session. I've got lots of URLs in this deck, so definitely make a note to download it. And while you're downloading it, fill out the evaluation. And the other one's Tech Ed New Zealand. The recording of the session I did last year is still online, so you can find out all the group policy Windows 8 goodness there. But you might ask, hey, is there any great books that I can buy about group policy that'll tell me I'm not really that into an advanced group policy? You know, who here kind of does group policy in their organisation or does group policy in their organisation? All right, so for those who didn't put your hands up, group policy is great. You should really learn about it. But you need to also learn about the new features. So is there a book that you could go out and buy today? Why, yes, there happens to be a book. A number of years ago, Jeremy Moskowitz came to TechEd New Zealand and I presented with him. He's another group policy MVP. That's his book. I don't get any endorsements or money, so this is not a paid advertisement or anything like that. It's just a really great book. I know it's a really great book because I was the technical editor on the book. All right? I don't get paid any more no matter how many copies he sells. He might, I don't know. But it is a great book, and it covers everything. It even includes Windows XP. Oh, my God. Yes. Windows, it's still supported, but a lot of the basics in Windows XP still hold true today. There are some, it goes from XP through to Windows 8. So if you got this book and then you looked at this session, you'd kind of know you'd be up to speed. So, all right, let's move along. What is new in group policy in Windows 8.1? Now, remember I said this is a point release. And this is the core functionality of group policy. All right, this is what's primarily different. IPv6 support. Who here has IPv6 deployed in their organization and deliberately deployed, not just that private automatic stuff that is by default? One hand, two hands. This feature is for both of you, okay? No. So, of course, implementing IPv6, you know, IP stack, it permeates through the layers of the operating system quite a lot. So, Microsoft, of course, have supported IPv6 in the client for a very long time. And yes, if you have an IPv6 network, you've always been able to have group policy. But who's heard of group policy preferences? Excellent. If not, I've done many a session before for Tech Ed New Zealand. Also, go back and download them. They're a great way of managing your environment and getting liberty logon scripts, things like drive mappings and stuff like that. It's really good. IPv6 support is coming in group policy preferences item level targeting. All right, so there's options within group policy preferences that allows you to target those settings a number of different ways. I think it's about 18 or 20 different ways you can target individual settings. It now supports IPv6. There's some new event logs. All right, so that's Windows 8.1 has, since Windows Vista. Who deployed Windows Vista? Oh, a couple people. Oh, congratulations. Are you off it yet? Are you off Windows Vista yet? Oh, you've survived. Okay, very good. Okay, so there's a couple of new event log events. So the event log's always been there, but there are definitely some more events there around the processing of group policy, how long it takes to process group policy. Gives you a lot more detailed information when you're troubleshooting performance in group policy. Of course, performance was never an issue in group policy, and I've come up on this stage before and said, you know, it's not really group policy's fault that things are running slow. It's the settings you have in your group policy that is causing your logon to be slow. Well, that was a good button. Oh. Well, guess what? They fixed the performance issues in group policy. So, generally speaking, group policy performs quite well in most organisations. However, there are some fringe cases where group policy doesn't perform as good as it can be. All right, who here has WAN links? Who here has slow WAN links? Who here has slow WAN links without domain controllers on the end of them? All right, so this is for you. All right. One of the things about group policy performance improvement is running logon scripts. Okay, logon scripts now are no longer running as the computer starts up. They're delayed by 5 minutes. All right, which there's a big impact if you have to make sure the logon script runs before the user logs on. This is all about having the user startup experience to be as quickly as possible when they turn their machine on. So basically what that means is the computer will turn on and then they might see a logon script pop up on their screen 5 minutes after they've logged on. Be aware of that. Yes, there is a group policy that you can restore the old behavior and making it run asynchronously. Sorry, synchronously, not asynchronously. All right, but just be aware of that. There are fewer synchronous policy settings. Synchronous policy settings are what kill people on slow WAN links without domain controllers on the end. When you change a group policy and it has a synchronous policy setting in it, right, it forces what they call a group policy synchronous refresh. Synchronous refresh requires the client to connect to the domain controller and pull down all those policy settings the next time they reboot or log on. In some organizations, that can take up to 20 minutes. If you had 100 group policy objects, the more group policy objects you had, if you had 100, it could take up to 20 minutes for the logon over a slow WAN link. Now, you might not have a slow WAN link, but who's heard of direct access? Right? Direct access is over the internet, and of course, that introduces latency. Right? So if you do a group policy update, you then have a policy change that has a synchronous setting in it, it means the next update for that user could take up to 20 minutes when they log on because the VPN or the direct access is established before they logged on. So to get around they've removed some of the synchronous policy settings which trigger this synchronous group policy processing, but they've also now introduced group policy caching. Yay, I can run group policy offline. Not. Okay, group policy caching, you need to be very specific about this. This is about doing group policy updates over a WAN link with high latency. What it will do, it will cache the group policies that are for that machine. If a synchronous group policy update happens, which gives you that 20-minute logon, it will actually retrieve it from cache. works very similar to slow link detection. You hit 500 milliseconds, it says, no, you're too slow, I'm going to bring it from cache rather than try to pull all those grip policies down over the domain controller, from the domain controller over a slow WAN link. And there's now, in the RTM, woohoo, an officially supported group policy that configures Windows 8.1 to boot straight to desktop. Now, if you've ever visited my website, you know I've put up a million and one hacks on how to do this otherwise. In the release preview, it was a registry key. There's now an officially supported group policy setting to do that. That is a setting, and I was talking about the core processing of group policy, but that was just one that was too good for me to miss to mention. I always like to throw these little nuggets in there. So Windows 8.1 is far more enterprise-friendly, and these are one of the settings that makes it far more enterprise-friendly in that you can now control that via group policy. So I'm going to do some demos. I broke it. Didn't clear. Oh, my machine went to sleep. Look at that. Oh, look. Thank you. I have the man here to change the video. All right. So a couple of things. So I was talking about synchronous group policy settings. One of those synchronous group policy settings, well, actually, no, I'll take a step back. I have a domain controller here. Just going to log onto my DC. Oh, that's not right. Excuse me while I just change. I know why. It's better. So what I'm going to do, this is set up to simulate having lots of group policy objects. I'm not going to be there in a minute, but just bear with me for a sec. I'm going to edit a group policy that's applied to a user. So this is Group Policy Management Console. We're all familiar with this, I hope. Yeah. All right, so I'm going to go in, and I'm going to do a drive mapping. This is Preferences Node, Windows Settings, Drive Mapping. So I'm going to do a group policy drive mapping for a user. Mapped drive. Okay, I'm going to just... Data. Who has W in their organization for work files? No one? No? Oh, most people have W. All right, so this is just a standard drive mapping. But here's the item level targeting. You're probably familiar with this. I go to the targeting option now, and I go new item. I go to IP address range. So there's the IP range. All right. Obviously, the IP range is one of those items that have been updated to support IPv6. And lo and behold, there is now a tick box there. Use IPv6. All right. Notice it's still an IPv4 box there, but as soon as I tick that, it swaps over to an IPv6 field. I can use a combination of IPv4 and IPv6 rules here. All right. If anyone knows anything about IPv6, doing that would be bad. That's 127.0.0.1. I'm pretty sure. It's been a while since I've learned IPv6. But that's an example of how they've introduced IPv6 targeting in group policy. All right, so a lot of the group policy preferences now, whenever there's a field there for IP address, they've now got that tick box there that says use IPv6. All right, so I'm going to go back and I'm just going to make this drive mapping. So I'm just going to set this drive mapping up for a user. I'm just going to make sure the user is logged on first. He's not. Very good. So this is John. John has a drive mapping, one I did earlier. So John doesn't have a drive mapping. All right, so drive mappings are one of those strange group policy settings that will only apply when the user logs on. So if you had to give a user a drive mapping, you could put them in the security group, it would do the drive mapping with group policy preferences, but then you'd have to tell them that the next time you log on, you'll get that drive mapping. Okay, look what happens now. Here's John. I'll go back to my domain controller. All right, got the drive mapping there. People group policy that's applied to John. I'm going to group policy update. Watch me make a typo. GP update. Watch the drive letters. Watching. Woo-hoo! Sorry, I just blew the speakers. So drive mappings now will dynamically apply to the user while they're logged on. All right? You do not have to wait for them to log off and log back on for those drive mappings to apply. That's pretty cool. That was pretty annoying. All right? So they've made that synchronous. That's all about keeping the user within Windows, never telling, having to tell the user to log off and log back on again. Okay. The other one I was going to show, and I'm just going to show, you can kind of take my word on this one, is this is just going to show you the new group policy. Nope. Not responding. That's never a good thing. Give me one second. What I was just going to show is something crash. Nope. Yay. Edit the group policy object. Policies, administrative templates, start menu. Really simple group policy name to remember. Called go to the desktop instead of starting when signing in or when the app screens are closed. Translation, boot to desktop. Turn that on, users will boot to the desktop. Okay, that's the one. Go to the start desktop. There's a few other group policies in there now that natively manage those. If you go into release preview, go on properties to the taskbar, you notice there's a few options there about starting, going to all programs menu. There's a lot of them in here now. Okay, I just wanted to show you that because, you know, in case you were looking for the boot to desktop, it's not called boot to desktop, it's called go to desktop. Okay. Okay, I'm going to kill that server. All right. That's pretty much it. And I need to cut over. I'll get this by the end of it. That's pretty much it for group policy. It's all about performance improvements. All right? They want to make Windows 8.1 as fast as possible in all as many scenarios as possible. Those edge cases are what they're attacking right now. Generally, group policy and performance has been quite good. But there were those edge cases, and that's what Microsoft have been working towards to improve that. Wait, I forgot a demo. How do I go back? Funny that. All right. So I was talking about logging on. I'm just going to delete my previous group policy. You can't see me. No, no. Man here. Well, while he's doing that, I'm just going to be doing some magic, which is called restoring a Hyper-V. So who here, and this is worth a prize, this mouse, who here knows how to force a group policy sync update? Nope. 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 Who said force slash sync? Someone, you said it? GP update. It's GP update slash sync. Close, but I'll give this to you. There you go. He wins a mouse. Yay. All right. GP update slash sync. Now, this is going to be a demo of how to, the performance difference between a Windows 8 machine starting and a Windows 8.1 machine starting. Now, this is my domain controller. This is called Newt. This is a tool that you can get off the internet that simulates WAN link connectivity. Just to show you, I double click on this link here. Latency is 250 milliseconds one way. Latency the other way, you can notice there, 250 milliseconds the other way. I'm just going to go start. Now this domain controller is behaving like it's got 500 milliseconds of latency on it. Now normally I've been doing this where I do the sessions, do the update side by side. Problem is Windows 8 takes forever to shut down. So if I do a GP update sync on both machines running at the same time, 1136. What will happen is the Windows 8.1 beats the pants off it, because also Windows 8 takes a long time to shut down. So instead, I've done a GP update sync on these two machines. This is Windows 8.1B, this is Windows 8B. Same user, same OU, same group policies. I'm going to connect to both. And this is kind of like a race. B's on the right, so on the left is Windows 8, on the right is Windows 8.1. And so, you know, there's no delay, I can go start. So I've just started both machines. Watch the difference. So we have high latency on the domain controller here. On the right, already Windows 8.1 is already ahead a bit. But while this is starting, because it's all really exciting to watch, and this is on a high latency WAN link, I do have some questions for you. Who can tell me one of the four group policy synchronization settings, the ones that require a force of a GP update to do a sync? They're the special ones that only apply when you reboot. Group. For who said that? Can you catch? I can't throw. That's all right. Who? Any others? Anyone else? No. Printers are dynamic. They'll apply. Applications. Any others? Drive mappings was one of them. No. So drive mappings was one of them. No longer. No. Someone said folder redirect. It's a really hard one. So you notice here on the right, Windows 8 is already kind of started. Windows 8.1 is already started, and I'm logging on using Windows 8.1. Windows 8 is still saying, please wait. All right. Bit of a performance difference already. Anyone else? USB memory stick? Something to do with disks? No. 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 It's something that no one ever, 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 ever uses. Something about disks. It's been around since Windows 2000. Starts with Q. Someone said, who said quotas? Yeah, you said quotas first. Disk quotas. No one ever uses them. But it's a synchronization setting. Now let me just log on to the Windows 8.1. Woohoo! Look, Windows 8.1 has won. Windows 8.1 has started, and I'm logged on in the time it's taken just the Windows 8 machine to start and ask for a control alt delete prompt. All right, bit of a difference there when you have a synchronization, sync pull-up policy setting processing over a slow WAN link. How am I going for time? 22 minutes. All right, so I'm going to move on now. Cut. To work folders. So work folders is a completely new thing with Windows 8.1. All right, it's a new feature with Windows 8.1 and Windows Server 2012 R2. This is the feature that I'm most excited about. Who here has ever used or seen any of these folder synchronization products and have them in the organization, and someone comes to them and says, hey, I just got Dropbox in my laptop. That's fine, isn't it? There's no security or compliance issues with having Dropbox on my machine, is there? I'll put all that confidential information in there. I see someone there hitting them on the head. Absolute nightmare. Not to mention there could be legal issues with having that information stored on a third-party provider. Microsoft's all about the cloud. Nothing wrong with the cloud. The cloud's not evil. But it might not be for you. You might want to do the same sort of thing, but you want to host it on site. Of course, the other one, SkyDrive, to be determined, whatever it's going to be called. Microsoft said they're going to rename SkyDrive. All right. So it's like an enterprise version of SkyDrive, all right, that you can synchronize on-premise, not in the cloud. I did it again. There we go. So work folders on the file server. Who here has file servers in their organization? Very good, I hope so. So it's a new file server role in Windows Server 2012 R2. So you do need a Windows Server 2012 R2 file server, all right, for this to work. That's the back end. So it's a new role. It doesn't use SMB, all right? It's a new file synchronization protocol over HTTPS. And HTTPS is the universally accepted firewall bypass port on every network in the world. Translation, the user should be able to get access to the files in most locations. Okay, because it's over HTTPS. Something else runs over HTTPS that has synchronization capabilities that Microsoft does. It also has things like the ability to secure remote, wipe remote devices. Anyone know what it's called? Active Sync. There is a lot of commonality in, what's the right word, in concept between work folders and Active Sync. You'll probably, if you know anything about Exchange and how mailbox setup works and how remote policies work, you'll see a lot of similarities between this and work folders. My elevator pitch is, it's like Active Sync for your files, not your emails. All right? So it's stored, the information though is stored on your file server. All right? So it's on a file server. You can still share the location. It's just a flat file via an SMB file share, which means if you do have Windows XP soon, so help you, or if you have clients that aren't compatible with work folders, you can still access those files via an SMB file share. Okay? It works with other file server roles. Distributed file replication, DFSR. You can replicate that information to another file server. Can't necessarily have work folders on the either end of that replication, so it would have to be a cold standby or a warm standby of the copy of the data, but you can replicate it. And I'll show you a few other things you can do with that. This is a question I get asked a lot. Can I have my files on an SMB file share? I have a Windows Server 2012 R2 file server that then references the UNC path of where my files are, say, on a Windows 2012 server. No, you can't. So this is a gotcha. The disk needs to be locally attached. What does that mean? They just need to present as a LUN. SAN, SAS, direct attached storage, whatever it is. Most people have that on their file server. You just can't access it via an SMB file share, which means the data needs to be connected to the server that's serving up the data. All right, you can't remotely access it. Like Hyper-V can remotely access the VHD files on an SMB share. You can't do that with this yet. One thing I will say, though, is if you have any questions about what about this, what about that, they said, the Microsoft employees have said many times that this is a V1 product. And what comes after V1? Well, V2. Yeah, and, you know. So they said this is a V1 product. They're obviously listening for feedback on what features need to go in. So there might be some features that you need. There's also a concept on the file server called a work folder share. So it's not an SMB share. It's now a work folder share. I'll show you, go through that with the demo and how to set that up. And it also requires SSL certificates, like it's HTTPS. In the preview, you could disable the requirement for SSL. In the RTM, you cannot. All right? Because this is a solution that can be accessed via the internet, it's highly recommended that you use publicly signed SSL certificates. All right? Keep that in mind. You can use privately signed ones, but then you have problems about distributing the certificate root authority file to all the machines that want to connect to your organization. So this is a bit of a table matrix here of a comparison of the different file synchronization solutions. SkyDrive is a consumer personal solution for personal devices. All right, you can get SkyDrive on most devices pretty much. There's a SkyDrive app or there's something, you know, you can have SkyDrive program on your computer. SkyDrive Pro requires SharePoint as a backend and it supports collaboration. Okay. Work folders is for an individual. You can only have a one-to-one mapping of a work folder to a work folder share. You can't share out, you can't have multiple people synchronizing the same work folder. All right? It's like a home drive. Think of it as a home drive. You don't share out home drives to multiple people normally. All right? And the folder redirection client-side cache is, again, it's the individual, but it's all SMB and you're only on Windows and you're much more limited. All right? So work folder clients. What computers and devices can I use to access work folders? All right, at the end of this, I'll ask people to put their hand up if you do not qualify. All right, hopefully I won't see many hands. Windows 8.1 domain joined. Yes, if you have a domain joined machine, you can absolutely use work folders and you can manage it quite well using a number of management technologies. Windows 8.1 non-domain joined. This means that Windows 8.1 device at home can be used to connect into your corporate file server. Just like if you have the Mail app in Windows 8, it can connect to the ActiveSync, same thing. All right? You can now, users can now access their work files from home. Windows 8.1 RT out of the box when it gets released will be able to support work folders natively. All right, so those 8.1 RT devices, those Windows 8 RT devices you bought are actually looking a lot better. Now it has Outlook, now it has work folders. There's two really great corporate enterprise apps that are coming to Windows 8.1 RT. All right, I think 8.1 RT is getting better a lot, especially for enterprises. Windows 7, you can download an agent, install it on your Windows 7 machines. It's just like an agent, a client agent. It's not out yet, but it is coming. All right, hold your breath. iPad. Who here has executives in their organizations with iPads? They can all access their work files on their iPads and they don't have to sell that leather-bound case that costs more than the iPad that's wrapped around it. And the Bluetooth keyboard, of course. All right? There will be an app coming out that supports the iPad at a future date. I've been told, I haven't been told when, but it sounds like it's going to be soon. All right? Don't know how soon. All right, but they're given assurances that it's not going to be long after GA. All right, so let's look at this. I'm now going to switch into kind of some demo mode. What is it? 31, so I've got 30 minutes. All right. Cut, I'm getting good at this. All right. Sorry about this, please bear with me. I'm going to turn that guy off. I'm going to turn my work folder server on. I'm going to turn my home computer on. Sorry about this. Windows 8.1. Clearly don't have. No, go away. Yep. Okay, this is my home computer. Actually, it's not. It's a virtual machine running on my laptop, but let's pretend it's my home computer. It's not domain joined. I don't have group policy. I don't have anything managing this machine. And there's my family. There's my three girls. It's my home machine. Of course I have my family background on the wallpaper over there. And the sysinternal tools, of course. So how do I set up work folders? I'm at home, I want to do work folders. Right, I right click on the start button, which is so fantastic. I'm so glad they put that in. And I go to control panel. I type work. Top of the list, work folders. All right, set up work folders. I'm now going to type in an email address. This wizard is slightly different in the RTM. Couldn't show you the RTM because the RTM bits don't work with the preview bits and I would have had to rebuild my entire lab and I didn't want to do that because things then break. I know this works, I hope. Very good. And now ask for a URL. All right, I'm just going to type this URL in here. It's really simple URL to remember. Users will have no problems whatsoever remembering all that, will they? Okay, it's pretty long. Let me zoom in on it. Okay, certainly in the RTM bits, the sync slash 1.0 requirement is gone. They'll automatically append that. But for now, I'm just going to do this to show you it working. It's going to ask me for my domain credentials. This is digest authentication over HTTPS. This could also be Active Directory Federation services, so you could have two-factor authentication in here. You could also use a new feature with Windows 8.1 Active or 2012 R2 Active Directory called Domain Workplace Join, which means that your RT devices or even your iPads can be a member of the domain as a device, meaning that they can be used as a way of authenticating. So users can authenticate. But for the purposes of this, I'm just going to go in and type, come on. Thank you. Remember my credentials. So it's used the email address to know who I am. It's used the work folders URL to find out where my work folder server is. It's now saying, where do you want me to save that work folder? It just sticks it in a folder under the user's profile, see users, Alan work folders, just like SkyDrive, just like Dropbox. You can change that, not in the preview bits. And here it's asking me some security policies. These are policies I, as the owner of this device, must accept before I can connect to the corporate organization, which says, no, you must have these policies, just like ActiveSync on the iPhone, but a little bit better, and I'll go into that soon. I accept these policies, I go set up work folders, and that's done. This is the work folder kind of overview panel. How does the user get to their work folders? They now have this work folder under their this PC here. So I can create files here. So what I'm going to show you is I'm going to jump to the file server itself. Yes, which is this one. Actually, I'm going to window it because I actually want to show you it working rather than just saying smoke and mirrors. Sorry about this. Did I turn off the slow network? Oh dear. There we go. Funny that it works faster when you don't make it slow. All right, so here I have a work folder. There's the user. There was my username at corp2, so this does support multiple domains in the same forest. And here's my work folder server here on the file server. I'm just going to window this, and it might look a little bit awkward because it's windowed, but I just want to really show you the effect. So, side by side. So on the left is I'm on the client, on the right is the file on the file server. I create a new text document. Boom, file's there. Pushes the file up to the file server, copies it across. Okay, that was a little bit tricky to set up though. That's pretty cool, yeah? Okay, very good. See, I got the New Zealand audience to clap. People said that was hard. So what I'm going to do now is that URL. And I'm going to start going really fast here. That URL was a bit difficult to set up. So now what I'm going to do is that if you use work folders as a domain name prefix, so work folders dot your domain name here, the work folder client will actually look for that domain name just like auto-discover in Exchange. Remember the auto-discover DNS? Same for work folders. Work folders. So this also uses SSL certificate. So I do need to do a couple things to swap this over. So first of all, I need to go to the domain controller and make my DNS alias that points me to the work folder server. So I've just created the DNS alias on the domain controller. I'm going to go to my work folder server. So work folders uses SSL certificates. I have two SSL certificates installed on this machine. I have one which is the machine name itself, which is server 03. And I have one called workfolders.corp2.local, which is the discovery URL. All right, so I need to swap this over. Now this is HTTPS, but it doesn't use IIS. It uses it's a .NET application web service. All right, so there's a netsh command that you run to manage the SSL certificate in the slide deck that I have. It has the links to the website that does all that. Of course, you can download this video. If I go show the certificate, shows me what certificate is installed. Here is the certificate hash. Doesn't give me the name. If I want to know, okay, which certificate is that, I go and have a look at my certificates here. I go to details tab. If I go scroll down the bottom, there's a thumbprint. Thumbprint there. DA84, those four, the rest of the numbers are fine, but if I stood here and read them all, you'd be all bored. DA84, that's the certificate I've got in use. I don't want that one, I want the work folders one. I clear it. This is the netsh command to clear it. Netsh http delete SSL cert. Cleared the certificate. Now I use this command, which has the hash of the, you're just going to trust me, that's the thumbprint of the certificate I want to use. Here's one I've typed out earlier. Paste that in. The certificate has been successfully added. Yay. Now the third thing I have to do, and I don't have to do it, but it would take a long time for the DNS cache to expire, is I need to clear the DNS cache because the work folder client has just looked up for workfolders.domainname. So I'm going to flush the DNS. Now I'm hoping that now I go in through the work folders control panel. That's not even close to work. All right, work folders. I stop using work folders. So as a user, I can stop it at any time. I start using work folders. Ask me for an email address still, because I need to know who I am. Hopefully users can remember their email address. If they can't, this product is not for them. Automatically discovered the work folder server via that DNS, all right, using HTTPS. So you can publish that through a reverse web proxy. That is a new role in Server 2012 R2. Server 2012 R2 now has a reverse web proxy service. So you put that on the perimeter and you publish your work folder server that way. All right, so I'm cool. I've got work folders set up at home. What about my organization, my corporate organization? Getting good at this. Excuse me. So as you see there on the left is when you set up a server work folder share, you get asked two questions. Do you want the users to have to encrypt the work folders? And do you want them to have a password? You tick those two. And then on the right, that's the question the user gets, which you would have seen when I walked through the wizard based on those two other tick boxes there. Now, something I didn't show you, but those files there are actually now green color, which means they're encrypted. So they've now got a new type of encryption on it. This is not EFS. This is enterprise encryption, which means those files are now encrypted, basically meaning that if the computer was to leave the organization, you could use something like Intune. That's a screenshot from the website about Windows Intune, the next wave, and you can do a selective remote wipe. What the selective remote wipe does is sends a message to the work folder's device and says, invalidate the private keys that are used to decrypt those files. It doesn't actually delete the files, but it makes them unreadable. So you've selectively remote wiped the enterprise data on their machine. It's not good if you didn't have that option, because otherwise you've just formatted the user's home PC. All right, so that's why it's enterprise selective wipe. That is how you do it in System Center 2012 R2. Okay, there's the UI to do that. So you do need those technologies in place if you want to support the selective remote wipe. How do you configure it? You can configure it via group policy. You can configure it via SCCM in Intune. Using those three methods, you can either have it as an opt-in, which means you can let the user go to the control panel, hit set up, and it kind of pretty much answers all the questions for them. So it's an opt-in, or you can force it. I'm going to show you how to do that in the demo. So the URL based is what I showed you how to set up before, so basically setting up the work folder's URL. Okay, and which is you type in the URL, and then also how do you do the auto-discover. So those two things, those ways, initiated by the user, but makes it easier for them to not have to remember really long URLs. I'm going to skip over this slide, but this is generally, I was talking about how you have a work folder in the organization and it has a reverse proxy, so your external devices hit the reverse proxy and your internal devices hit the work folder server directly. So I really want to show you this all working. So now I'm going to show you, see I did fade. Cuts too easy now, I'm graduating to fade. All right, so now what I'm going to show, oh did I break it? No, okay. So now what I'm going to show you is, this is the work folder server. All right, I'm going to set up a work folder share. This is the one I just did the SSL certificate. So to do this, you go into Server Manager. Let Server Manager load. You go to local server, go to the file server, and storage service. This is the new role, work folders here. Here's a work folder I set up previously. Something I didn't mention, I should have mentioned, sorry, is that the work folder user needs to be in a security group. The shares is mandatory. You can't do a work folder share for everyone. They must be in a security group for that share. All right, that's an absolute requirement. So it's a little bit different to an SMB share that way. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through, and I don't have WF2, work folder share, folder 2. I'm just creating a second share here. I'm going to create a new work folder share. This is the wizard. It says, yep, it's server 03. It says role not clustered. This could be a clustered file server if you wanted to. 15 minutes. Okay, I'm going to select that share. It's a completely new share. So it's E drive WF2. Go next. I can either select user alias or user alias with at domain. So if you want to keep it unique in your organization, I use the user by itself if I want to lay the work folder role over top of my user's existing home drives. right? Because the user home drives are normally their username, right? If I don't want that at corp bit, I can use the top option and do that. If I did that, then I probably would only want to go tick this option here and sync only the following folder to the subdirectory, which would be probably the documents directory. Maybe not. Maybe I create a new folder in their home directory structure profile on the file server. But for now, I'm just going to select this option here. What's the name of the share? WF2. The user never sees that file share name. But now I have to specify the security group. So John is a user of the work folders group called work folders 2 users. I'm going to deselect that disable inherited permission. This is where you get prompted. Do I want to encrypt the files? Yes, I do. I click that. I go create. Done. The share is done. It now enumerates the group membership, sets all that up. It already knows John is a member of that group, and it tells me there. If I want details about that user, I can actually look at the properties of that detail and actually find all the devices that user is using to synchronize with the file server share and the last time they did that. All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to... 46. All right. Sorry, I really don't want to run out of time because there's so much goodness I want to show you. So... I'm going to connect to my domain join machine here. Yep, that's it. I'm going to log on as John, and I'm going to go into the control panel here, go work folders. Now, nothing up my sleeve here, work folders is not configured for this user. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go back to, did we all see that? I didn't install Zoom it on it. So I'm going to go back now to my domain controller. I'm going to go open the group policy. Here's one I configured earlier again. It's a user policy, administrative templates, Windows components. I like it because it's right down the bottom, so it's easy to find. Work folders. Specify work folder settings. So this is specifying the client settings for that user. Notice here, that's the URL. Notice how it's /s there. You won't have to specify that in the RTM version. And I've also ticked the box that says force automatic setup, which means this will just configure it and do it for the user. Okay? So I'm going to hit OK there. So that policy is already configured, but I'm going to now enable that link. So now John has the policy to apply group the work folders. I'm going to do a GP update force. Wait for that policy to apply. Any questions yet? While that GP update's happening?
One question.
Yep.
When you edit the work folders by the URL.
Yes. Sorry, work folders by the URL. Yep.
Sorry, I put the certificate on.
Yep. Oh, that's because I ticked that box as a remember credentials. There is an option in the control panel there that says change credentials. For the user. Yeah, that's very sticky too. If you try then specify someone in the preview bits, if you specify even someone else's email address, it'll actually say, no, that works. Doesn't work because it's trying to use the old credentials that you ticked as remember. So I'm going to log on as John. I've did a GP update and I have to log off and log back on. I don't know if this is a synchronous policy setting yet or not. I haven't tested in the RTM, so they might have actually introduced this as a synchronous policy setting. But I have noticed in the preview that I do need to go in and log off and log back on. If I go back into control panel here and I go work, and I really hope it's set up and it's green. Yes! Work folders for John. Hey, I'll take another clap. It is now set up automatically in your organization. So that shows you how easy it is to deploy. They don't have to do anything. You just have to deploy Windows 8.1, which is really easy to do, isn't it? All right, so this is work folders for John. All right, but what about... John's just your regular everyday Joe Schmo user, and he doesn't deal with any confidential information like that whatsoever. I'm going to be skipping some of the slides here. Yep, 10 minutes to go. But I do want to show. Demos are good, aren't they? Demo good, PowerPoint bad. Yep, okay, so more demos. Yep, okay, remember that, evaluations. Okay, so I'm going to log on as Alan. That's a great name. So Alan's now logging on to the domain join machine. Hopefully, too, he has his work folder set up because he's subject to the same group policies as John is. But Alan is in a different group, which means he's going to get assigned to a different work folder share on the same server. So type work here, hopefully, please, please, yes. It's also configured for Alan. So he gets configured to a different server though. So the file server, and I mentioned this before, works folder role, works complementary with the file server resource manager. Who's familiar with the file server resource manager? A couple of hands going up, you can do great things with the file server resource manager, and all these things work with work folders. I can do disk quotas. Notice here I've implemented a per folder, not group policy, per folder disk quota here from the users on that folder, eWork folders. Says it's 100 meg limit. Let's go back to work folders. It knows that there's a per folder quota put on the user's folder there and tells the user how much space they have available left to them through this UI. So it's smart enough to say how much free disk space they've got left on their work folders. If you hit the limit, you can still pile as many files as you want into that work folder locally. It just won't replicate up to the server. Yeah, it'll start throwing errors to say. So you notice there down the bottom it says no file errors. It'll say there driver's full. All right, so the users can kind of maintain that. So that's one. Another thing you could do is file screening. File screening is the ability to block certain types of files. In this case, I have blocked audio and video files, which basically is MP3s. So I'm going to go back to the client. And, you know, Alan likes his music. So he has a music. There's a great song called Music. So he has an MP3 file. He thought, well, I really love this song. I just ripped it at home. I'm going to take it to work and listen to it there. Oh, I don't have my USB memory stick with me. Oh, I'll just stick it in my work folder. So actually, before I do that, watch down here. It says no file errors. I'll drag it into my work folder. Bang. Error. Access is denied. Work folder tries to replicate that to the file server. The file server says, nah. And it then tells the user, no, you can't replicate this file. It's access denied. Right, so you can block on file type the types of files that the user can synchronize. All right. It even gets better.
If they change the MP3.
Yep, if they change it, they could do that. That's a workaround with file classification. Of course, then if they tried to rename it in their work folder back at work, it would go access denied. They don't have to copy it. They could do that, yes. Don't tell them that they can do that. They're not usually that smart. But the file server resource manager role can give you reports then on what types of files are in that on in other locations. I have not played around with the RTM a lot, but a number of times I have seen down here in the status bar an error warning message come up that says go to the control panel and find out more. I haven't seen it for this file block, but when there's file conflicts and stuff like that, the UI that the Explorer status bar does throw a warning message that sends them to the control panel. But I think that's something that is improved in RTM. I haven't confirmed that yet. So you move the file successfully from the desktop to where it is on the local hard drive, because all I'm doing here is moving it on the local hard drive from one location to another. This is this enterprise control. Notice how that file is green there. I can go remove enterprise control that way. What happens if the file stays there every 24 hours? The enterprise control will get whacked back on that file. All right, if I move that file out of my work folders to my desktop, it still stays under enterprise control. All right, enterprise control of those files stays wherever it is on that machine. If I copy that file to a USB drive, though, the user will get told, you're about to copy this file to a location that doesn't support enterprise control or encryption, and they have to accept the fact that what they're doing is removing the enterprise control. At the end of the day, the file is on their machine. Until you send that remote wipe, they have access on that file, and at the end of the day, if they've got a USB memory stick, they can copy the file probably from work to home anyway. So, is that audited? No. So Active Directory rights management is the default go-to if you need to really encrypt those documents. But there's some other stuff that you can do to keep the documents secure. I'm glad you asked that question, sir. I don't have anything to give you. Unless you want like a phone screen cleaner. I have heaps of those. You have one of those? Sorry. There we go. I've got a pile here. You can come up and get them afterwards. Okay, so what I'm going to do, 5 minutes to go. Cool, I can do this. All right, I'm going to go to the main controller. So notice, not the main controller, file server. File server classification. I have a file server classification rule here that says any file with that has the word confidential in it will be classified as a high impact file. This is a file management task that says on demand when or continuously running. If something happens, do a file expiration. Now, file expiration from the end user point of view looks like the file's been deleted, but all it's really doing is taking that file and moving it somewhere else because it says, no, you really shouldn't keep that information in your work folder because, you know, that's confidential information and we want to try to keep a cap on that confidential information. So let's look at that working. I'm going to go to Alan's work folder share here. I'm going to do the side-by-side thing again. I'm going to log on. So, must, what's something confidential? Not tell people about this. It is confidential. Is that spelled? Okay, so what I'm going to now do, I'm going to do side by side. So I'm going to copy that confidential file into my work folders on the client. File appears on the file server. Now the file server right now has triggered a content filter on that. It's scanning through that document for the word confidential. It then assigns the status of that file as high. The rule kicks in and it gets rid of the file off that server. It's expired the file and moved it to an expired location. Okay, so if the user goes, where's my file gone? What happens then is 5 minutes later, the work folder client will see that change. It is not pushed from the file server down to the client. Be aware of that. All right, it's pushed from the client to the file server. So basically it means if you have multiple devices all synchronizing to the same location, you have about a 5 minute lag between those devices. All right, so from your iPad to your Windows machine. Yep, question. Does it also work in the metadata of the file? I think you probably could do a rule around that. I'm not 100% sure. It certainly looks at the content. I'd say so. I'd say it's likely. You base it on time, date. What sort of metadata you'd be thinking about? Within a time period. Yeah. At the end of the day, it's files on a file server. If you had a script that ran through the file server that looks for time and date of the file, you could remove all those files. You wouldn't even have to use File Server Resource Manager. You could do that. All right, got through all my demos. Yay, 3 minutes left. I'm going to go really fast through the slides. So, working with file server roles. I showed you how per user quotas work. I showed you how file screening works. File server deduplication. So if you have deduplication running on your file server, it also works with that. So you save space like that. Supports DFSR replication, file server classification, which I showed you, how it got rid of that file. And one of the things with the file classification can do is automatically, instead of moving that file somewhere, it could automatically implement Active Directory rights management on that file. It basically encrypts the document so only that user itself could open that file, even if they then forwarded that email onto a friend or someone nasty. Showed you the content management. So getting started, what do you need to do? You need to build a Windows 2012 R2 file server. All right, get that started. TechNet is for people, while it still exists, TechNet is for people to do testing in their organization. So get the GA bits on TechNet and test, you know, completely within your legal rights to test this scenario. So you can start running up a bit of a lab in the work at the moment. It's not used for production, of course. Add the file server role to the file server. Set up the work folder share. Remember to add the users to the security groups because they need to be a member of the security groups. Get the client, the only clients that are available at the moment. Hey, look at that. I did the whole session on battery and it's now about to go flat. That was good timing. And get the client on for Windows 8.1, the release preview or the production bits. For future client support is coming. iPad's coming. Windows 7 is coming. There's a big article there on how to set up a test lab, so definitely download the slides. So key work folders takeaway, empower your users to be more productive by accessing the information they need wherever they are on their device, whether it be corporate or personal. All right, it's pretty simple to deploy. It's a lot simpler than using SkyDrive Pro and having SharePoint backend. Sorry, you SharePoint fanboys and girls. It is a lot simpler. It's a file server role. Fully leverage your existing file server infrastructure in your environment. Okay. Maintain control of the data, though, in the organization. So it's about giving users access to the data, but also making sure that they don't go wild with that data. Heaps of slides there. Related content. There is another work folder session. On Thursday at 5:45, it'll go into even more depth than this. But hopefully I've whet your appetite enough to say you want to go back to work and do this. I have 0 seconds for questions, but I will take questions down here after the session. Please fill out your evaluations. Thank you for coming to TechEd.